Hachette Audio presents Not the End of the World, How We Can Be the First Generation to Build a Sustainable Planet. Written and read by Hannah Ritchie.
Introduction. It has become common to tell kids that they're going to die from climate change. If a heat wave doesn't get them, then a wildfire will, or a hurricane, a flood, or mass starvation. Incredibly, many of us hardly blink before telling our children the story. It shouldn't then come as a surprise that most young people think their future is in peril. There's an intense feeling of anxiety and dread about what the planet has in store for us. I see this daily in the emails that land in my inbox, but it's also reflected in research from across the world. A recent global survey asked 100,000 16 to 25-year-olds about their attitudes to climate change. More than 3/4 thought the future was frightening, and more than half said humanity was doomed. The feelings of pessimism were widespread, from the UK and US to India and Nigeria. Regardless of wealth or security, young people the world over feel like they're hanging on for dear life. In the same survey, 2 in 5 were hesitant to have children. In a 2020 poll of American adults, of all ages, without children, 11% said climate change was a major reason for not having them, and 15% more said it was a minor reason. In younger adults, aged 18 to 34, the share was even higher. One respondent said she felt like, I can't in good conscience bring a child into this world and force them to try to survive what may be apocalyptic conditions. Of those surveyed, 6% said they regretted having children because they felt despair about their future in a changing climate. It's tempting to dismiss these views as empty words, but a recent study, not looking at surveys, but actual data on people's reproductive decisions, suggests non-environmentalists are 60% more likely to have children than committed ones. Of course, this may not be the only reason environmentalists are less likely to have children, but it gives us some concrete evidence that when people say they're anxious about having kids, they're not bluffing. If people aren't bluffing about their hesitation to have kids, they're probably not bluffing about their feelings of doom and anxiety either. Closer to home, I know these feelings are real because I've been there. I too used to be convinced that I didn't have a future left to live for. How to turn the world upside down. I spend most of my time thinking about the world's environmental problems. It's my job and my passion, but I nearly gave up on it. In 2010, I started my degree in environmental geoscience at the University of Edinburgh. I showed up as a fresh-faced 16-year-old, ready to learn how we were going to fix some of the world's biggest challenges. 4 years later, I left with no solutions. Instead, I felt the dead weight of endless unsolvable problems. Each day at Edinburgh was a constant reminder of how humanity was ravaging the planet. Global warming, sea level rise, ocean acidification, dead coral reefs, starving polar bears, deforestation, acid rain, air pollution, overfishing, oil spills, and the annihilation of the world's ecosystems. I don't remember hearing about a single positive trend. During my time at university, I made a conscious effort to keep up with the news. I needed to be informed about the state of the world. Everywhere were images of natural disasters, droughts, and hungry faces. More people seemed to be dying than ever before. More were living in poverty, and more children were starving than at any time in history. I believed I was living through humanity's most tragic period. As will be seen, all of these assumptions were wrong. In fact, in nearly every case, the world was moving in the opposite direction. You might think such basic misconceptions would be squashed during a 4-year stint at a world-leading university. They weren't. If anything, they became even more ingrained, the shame of our ecological sins getting heavier with every lecture. Those years made me feel helpless. Despite working relentlessly to get my degree, I was ready to turn my back on my obsession and find a new career path. I started applying for jobs far away from environmental science. Then, one evening, everything changed. I saw bubbles darting across the television screen. A small man was chasing after them. In my lifetime, former colonies gained independence, and finally they started to get healthier and healthier and healthier. Now here they come. Countries in Asia and Latin America start to catch up with the Western countries. The bubbles were red and green and superimposed on a graph that looked almost holographic. The man started waving his arms around, pushing and then dragging the bubbles across the screen. His excitement made it hard to pin down his accent, but I thought he might be Swedish. "And here Africa comes," he shouted. The man was Hans Rosling. If you know of him already, you can probably remember the first time you were introduced. If you don't, I'm a bit jealous. You still have the chance to discover his magic for the first time. Rosling was a Swedish physician, statistician, and public speaker. A review of his work in Nature captures him well. 3 minutes with Hans Rosling will change your mind about the world. It changed mine. You see, my understanding of the world was wrong. Not just slightly wrong. I'd assumed everything was getting worse. Yet here was Rosling, leaping across the stage, showing me facts rooted in solid data. He was telling me that I had it all the wrong way round. But he did it in a way that meant I didn't feel like an idiot. I was supposed to get it all wrong. Everyone does. This became his main act. He would get crowds of intellectuals, business leaders, scientists, and even global health experts at TED, Google, or the World Bank, and he'd show them that they were completely ignorant of the most basic facts about the world. And they'd love it. Watch his videos, and you can hear the audience laughing at their own ignorance. He had a generosity as a teacher that is impossible to replicate. In his lectures, Rosling explained what the data really told us about the most important metrics of human well-being: the percentage of people living in extreme poverty, the number of children dying, how many girls did or didn't get to go to school, and what percentage of children are vaccinated against diseases. We almost never step back to look at the data on these changes in global development. Instead, we watch the daily news, and those headlines become part of our worldview. But doing this doesn't work. The news is designed to tell us, well, something new. An individual story, a rare event, the latest disaster. Because we see them in the news so often, unlikely events seem like probable ones. But they're often not. That's why they make the news and why they capture our attention. These individual events and stories are important. They serve a purpose. But it's a terrible way to understand the bigger picture. Many changes that do profoundly shape the world are not rare, exciting, or headline-grabbing. They are persistent things that happen day by day and year by year until decades passed and the world has been altered beyond recognition. The only way to really see these changes is to step back and look at the long-run data. This is what Hans Rosling did for social problems. The same is true for environmental ones. I've been researching, writing, and shouting about these trends for almost a decade now. I'm head of research at Our World in Data, where we do this for every single one of the world's big problems, from poverty and health to war and climate change. I'm also a misfit scientist at the University of Oxford. We're misfits because we do the opposite of what people expect academics to do. Researchers tend to zoom into a problem to get as close as possible and pick it apart. We zoom out. My job is not to do original studies or to make scientific breakthroughs. It's to understand what we already know, or could know if we studied the information we have properly. Then explain it to people in articles, on the radio, on TV, and in government offices so they can use it to move us forward. Just as Hans Rosling showed that news headlines don't teach us much about global poverty, education or health, I found that trying to build an environmental worldview based on the latest wildfire or hurricane is no good. Trying to understand the world's energy system and how to fix it from the latest breaking story won't get us anywhere. If we want clarity, we have to take in the full picture, and that means giving ourselves some distance. If we take several steps back, we can see something truly radical, game-changing and life-giving. Humanity is in a truly unique position to build a sustainable world. Why doomsday thinking is so damaging. We need people to wake up. We need people to start paying attention.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.